Today we have Dr. P.C. Manoria, an eminent cardiologist from Bhopal. Thank you so much, sir, for joining us and taking out time. We are going to discuss a very important topic, dyslipidemia, and which forms a major component of metabolic syndrome as well as puts the person on a huge risk of coronary artery disease. Sir, can you tell us about dyslipidemia issues in India?
Dyslipidemia is a very common problem in the Indian context, and it accounts for 50% of CHD events. So this risk factors must be modulated so as to minimize the risk of coronary heart disease.
Sir, which any particular differences between Indian dyslipidemia and Western population?
In the Indian context, diabetes is rampant, triglyceride levels are high, HDL levels are low, total cholesterol and LD levels are also high, but not to the extent compared to the West. So Indian dyslipidemia is little different, and LPA is also elevated, which is genetically determined.
What type of strategies the monitoring and should be done? Means which any particular patient should be monitored, or any particular type? You already said about diabetes. Other than diabetes, any other conditions where dyslipidemia should be specifically looked for?
Now, there are several secondary causes of dyslipidemia also. For example, hypothyroidism is one of them, but majority of them are primary dyslipidemias.
You see patients with coronary artery disease almost every day. So in them, what percentage of patients present with dyslipidemia, and which are the specific type of factors which are very...
The prevalence of dyslipidemia is virtually 60-70%, although the exact statistics are not available on a national level in the Indian context, but some studies have shown that the prevalence of dyslipidemia is very high in patient presenting HCHD.
And what percentage of patients you see they are controlled with?
Although we prescribe drugs when they come for our consultation, but after a lapse of few months or year, the compliance is decreased. Maybe because of cost or because the patient feels better. Long-term compliance is not seen in large number of patients. Over the months and years, it declines.
What percentage of patients would be typically get control with medicines available as of now?
Now, we usually use high dose or high intensity statin therapy, either atorvastatin 80 milligrams or rosuva 40 milligrams, and this controls LDL levels to a great extent. But there are some percentage of patients where LDL levels still cannot be controlled. Either the drug is not able to control them to its fullest extent, or the patient gets intolerance and other side effects. Particularly, for example, you see familial dyslipidemia, even 80 milligram atorvastatin will not bring down the LDL level to targets.
Yeah, familial dyslipidemia is another important subject you mentioned, sir. It is often undiagnosed and people are not able to diagnose it. Any particular reason for that?
Because the incidence and prevalence of familial dyslipidemia is low. So it is not a common practice to screen for it. But if the LDL level is very high, say 190 or more, you should suspect it.
Okay. So if the patient is presenting with very high LDL,
or you have xanthomas, you have premature arcus annulus in the eyes, or premature coronary artery disease, and a history in the family, all this will point towards familial dyslipidemia.
You also mentioned about intolerance. In your practice, how frequently you see patients having intolerance?
See, muscle symptoms may be seen in 10 to 15, but the real intolerance, which means CPK more than 10, is less common. So if you want to know that CPK elevated 10 times and then declare it as statin intolerant, maybe 1, 2 or at the most 5%. But muscle symptoms 10 to 15%.
What is the role of non-statin lipid lowering agents according to you at this part of time?
Only one drug, ezetimibe, has shown outcome benefit in the IMPROVE-IT trial, which was released a year back. Triglyceride lowering agent, although we know triglyceride high is associated with coronary artery disease, but there is as yet no randomized dedicated prospective trial which has shown that you lower triglyceride levels, the CAD or CHD comes down.
So non-lipid lowering agents, you said one is ezetimibe, and anything about fibrates?
It blocks the, ezetimibe blocks the absorption of absorption of the cholesterol from the gut, so the LDL levels are decreased. Fibrates, although the diabetologists commonly use, we always say triglycerides are very important, but the only evidence of fibrate at the present time is the ACCORD LLA subgroup study, which showed that in the subset of patients where triglycerides are more than 200 and HDL is low, there is a benefit. But the overall trial was negative. But subgroup studies, as we say, are only hypothesis generating, and this has to be tested in a large prospective randomized trial, which is not investigated at the present time. So at the moment, the rational basis of lowering triglycerides from the point of view of changing the outcome are not there. This should have been investigated, but as we said, triglycerides have not been properly investigated, and still there is a big question mark whether triglyceride lowering will alter the outcome of CAD. For prevention of pancreatitis, of course, they are mandatory.
Patients often ask about diet also. Any particular advice you give to them when you say patients with dyslipidemia?
Now, diet is very important, but one should have a very clear concept that diet only constitutes to 20% of the total cholesterol. 70% of the cholesterol is manufactured in the liver. So even if you are on a stringent diet, you cannot drastically reduce the cholesterol levels. You have to use statins, and that is very important to remember. Or you may, even on dietic restrictions, if the body manufactures more, your LDL levels may still be elevated. But diet alone will not bring or will not delipidate the plaque also. It is statins which delipidate the plaques. So statin use is mandatory if you are a CHD patient or if you are at a high risk of COD.
The latest AHA guidelines do not recommend any particular target. They only say that you give high or mixed statin depending on the risk factors, and subsequently you expect a particular draw, whereas ESC is not
yes.
in the standpoint. So what should the Indian...
When the ACC guidelines were introduced, at that time the data of improvement in CV outcome was available only with statins. Later on, when this IMPROVE IT trial came in, the data was available that if you have a lower cholesterol in a combination with statin plus ezetimibe, the benefit is still there. So in times to come, it is very likely that the ACC will issue a focused update that LDL levels are mandatory. The other reason for revising the guidelines, again, LDL lowering is, LDL levels are mandatory, is the PCSK9. Now, when you use diet alone, cholesterol may be decreased by 10% or maybe 15%. If you use statins, it decreases LDL cholesterol by another 50%. So if you use diet plus statin, it is 60%, maybe 65. If you use PCSK9 on top of that, it produces an additional 50% reduction. Suppose you have a LDL level after, say, high dose statin 70. Another 35 milligram will be reduced. So now we have a pan-LDL control. You can decrease in the intake, you can block the absorption, you can block the synthesis by statin, and the PCSK9, they are the only pathway for clearance of the cholesterol through the LDL receptors. So now we have data from two trials, the ODYSSEY long-term and the OSLER, although these were not outcome trial, but they have shown reduction in the cardiovascular event. And on the basis of this, the FDA and the EMA has approved two PCSK9 inhibitor, evalucumab and the elarucumab. And it's very likely that the long-term three outcome trials which are going are likely to be positive. So in today's scenario, you cannot avoid LDL target. You have to measure LDL target. Although now statin trial has been done looking at the targets. So that was the reason. But now we have the improved trial, we have the PCSK9 data, and we have a sort of pan LDL control over it. Statin, diet control, ezetimibe, and PCSK9. You can virtually squeeze LDL to very low levels, and the interesting part is that low LDL levels are not harmful. That we know, we have data from the previous PROVE IT trial also, LDL less than 40, TNT trial 5 years, or less than 30 or 40, and the normal LDL is also low. So when we are trying to lower LDL, say from 130, 40 to 60, 50 or 40, we are reaching normal LDLs and not low LDLs, which is a physiological range when the newborn is born. So one should not have a scare.
So you are saying even if the doctors are seeing a levels of 45 to 55,
yes,
they don't have to change any therapy.
You are bringing it to near normal, sir. Then lowering pathology. This is physiological lowering and not pathological lowering, because you are born with LDL somewhere 40, 50.
40, 45, yes. That IMPROVE trial also clearly showed that the lower the better.
Lower is better.
So any particular thing you will say about the levels, going back to the level again, do the physicians should target the levels based on the risk factors, or for anybody who is presenting with coronary artery disease or having even a single risk factor, the level should be?
See, another peculiar feature of statin is whatever is your LDL levels, the CTT meta-analysis, it brings out 25% of the coronary events, where your LDL to begin with is less than 70 or 80, 90, 100, whatever, because statins are drug which do not improve CV outcome by just lowering LDL. They have pleiotropic effects. So from the point of view of initiating statins, if your patient has a CHD, which means stroke, PVD, or coronary artery disease, high dose statin right from the word go. If you are at high risk of coronary artery disease, still high dose statins. If you have a moderate or low risk, you may have used low dose. So from the point of your atherosclerotic CVD, high dose statins to begin. You may not monitor LDL right before initiating. But after you have initiated statins, whether PCSK9 would be useful or not, because at the present state of time, the dicta is if the LDL goals are not achieved less than 70, we would like to add PCSK9 inhibitors. And then when you add a PCSK9, there's an entire 50 to 60% reduction. So monitoring is mandatory.
Below 70, if the patient is what you suggested, especially if the patient has risk factor and if they are
not. See, classical example is familial hyperlipidemia. Many of them will. Why we use PCSK9? There are three indications. One, familial hyperlipidemia, besides LDL, apheresis, statin, ezetimibe, still you are not able to control, and they had very high risk of premature coronary artery. Many of them die. Second is you develop intolerance to statin. And third, you are a high risk individual, you have used maximum dose of LDL, the target is still not achieved. Target at the moment is 70. For the high risk, but I'm sure this is going to decrease to 40 or 50. Many people would agree, although guidelines take a lot of time because they are based on trials.
Yeah.
Very difficult to conduct trial for every small. So the targets will be lowered.
One of the fears which physicians have about statin is they may impair the glucose control, or they may actually pre-diabetic patients may get converted into full-blown diabetic. So any particular thing you would like?
See, if you really look at the data of the diabetogenicity of statins, what happens, those who are destined for diabetes develops at 6 months or maybe little more earlier. It's not that a non-diabetic individual will develop diabetes. By this I mean, suppose you have a high body mass index, your waistline is more, you are obese, and other risk factors for diabetes. Those who are destined to become diabetes, they develop diabetes statin. Not suppose you are normal individual, normal BMI, nothing, he will not develop diabetes. So it hastens the development of diabetes rather than brings up diabetes in a totally non-predisposed individual. That is important. Time and again people say diabetes, it has a diabetogenicity, but this is for the person who is destined. They will get, even if you don't start statin, they will develop diabetes in 6 months. So that should be remembered.
Statin should not be only.
No, they benefit diabetic patients also. But the reality is this.
One final question. Often there is a tendency to, for the patients and doctors, to stop a therapy once the control is achieved, which happens with blood pressure, it happens with diabetes. You might be seeing that happening even with the statins when it comes to lipid lowering. So what should we do if the levels are normal? Can it be stopped?
See, for primary prevention, we have now very good data from the WASCOP 20-year follow-up. You take statin 5 years and enjoy the benefit for the next 20 years. So we have now a documented data with this WASCOP trial, which is a primary prevention trial. So we may say you take statin for 5 years and the continue, we have a documentation that events continue to decrease, may be good. But for secondary prevention, we do not have such long-term data. And secondary prevention is very important to assess and reassess the risk. if your risk continues to be high, say after 5 years or 3, I don't think it makes a point in stopping statin, because he has already developed the disease, and if you allow him to develop a second event, this may be. So secondary prevention, our policy is little stricter. We continue to reassess. We don't have a pinpoint answer you will take for 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, just like diabetes. If you want to control diabetes, you have to continue. Because he has already developed a disease, it has to be a long-term therapy. But if you want a pinpoint question number, we continue to reassess if he is 5 years, he is still. But if the patient is tolerating the drug, it's better to have the statin. Because the plaques are delipidated only by statins at the present time. What PCSK9 do will be known little later.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.